In this video, we're going to be looking at conducting tests involving paired differences. So hypothesis testing. For paired differences. Another way to think about this is if your data are dependent. If your two groups are dependent on one another, this is usually the way to do that. And the most common way to get paired data is if you have a before and after measurement for the same group of individuals. So you have, individual one, let's say, and we have their weight, let's say, before a diet and then after, whatever their weights were. And then individual two, we have their before and after, and individual three, before and after. I can't treat these as two independent groups because it's the same individuals in both group, and your weight before the diet is likely to have an impact on your weight after the diet. If you started out before your diet weighing 200 pounds, you can't expect that same person necessarily after their diet to come down to 105. As opposed to somebody who starts at 110, it's perfectly reasonable to expect them to come down to 105. So the before would have a big impact on the after. And therefore, these data are not two independent samples. The befores are not independent from the after. So we need a different method for doing a hypothesis test for that than we would use if the data were independent. Okay, so basically, the key though is that the data need to be paired. So it doesn't necessarily even have to be a before and after. That's most common, but you could also have data that were paired by region. If you have some polling results, and you have, let's say, different voting regions. So there was region 1, 2, 3, and so on. And maybe you were looking at their polling results from last year's election, and then this year, and then last year, and then this year, last year, this year, last year, this year. Well, same idea. Region 1's last year results are likely to have an impact on their this year results. Things don't change quite that much from year to year regionally. So because it's the same group of regions that are included in last year's results and this year's results, there is a pairing that exists. We can pair region 1's last year with region 1's this year. And region 2, we can pair their last year with their this year, and last year with this year, and so on and so forth. So that's why it's called paired data. There has to be a meaningful way to create pairs of data here. Now, the process for testing hypotheses involving paired differences is completely different from the process for testing the other types of hypotheses that we've talked about so far. First of all, the test that we use, the test structure, is going to be really different. Your null hypothesis for all tests involving paired differences is that you are testing for the mean difference in the sets of data. And that is symbolized by mu representing the mean sub d. So this is mean difference. And the default assumption is that your mu sub d, or the mean difference between the two groups, is zero. In other words, a difference does not exist. Okay, the difference is zero. Now that's going to be your null hypothesis for all of this type of hypothesis test. For your alternate hypotheses, you will have, three choices, just like always, a greater than, a less than, and not equal to. So you could be looking for a mean difference that's greater than zero, you could be looking for a mean difference that's less than zero, or you could be looking for a mean difference that's not equal to zero. Okay, so which one you use is just going to depend on the wording in the problem. Then, the test that we're going to run is we're going to run a t-test, but we're going to run it on L3. We're actually going to have three lists of data when we do a problem like this, and it's the third list of data that we will be running the test on. So t-test on L3. Okay. So, assumptions and conditions that need to be met here, conditions for inference, we need to have did my assumptions and intuitions go? Okay, well, we need to have a simple random sample. We need to have paired data. Otherwise, this method will not work. And we need to know that the differences are mound-shaped and symmetric. Or it could say normal. That would be fine. Or we need to have at least 30, greater than or equal to 30, but here the n is referring to the number of data pairs. Okay, so if we go like back up here, we would need to have polling results from 30 different regions, or we would need to have before and after measurements from the diet for 30 individuals. Okay, unless we know that the differences between those two groups are mound-shaped and symmetric. At that point, any number of data points will work. Okay. So here we go. Gonna grab us an example problem here. Sorry, my electronic textbook is not cooperating with me. Let's see. Okay, here we go. So this is looking at information from Rocky Mountain National Park, and it says at 5 weather stations on Trail Ridge Road in Rocky Mountain National Park, we have peak wind gusts in miles per hour for January and April, and they're recorded below. So the weather station number, we have 5 of them, 1, 2, 3, 4, and 5. And then we have information for January and April. And this is peak wind gust that we're looking at. January's peak wind gust from weather station 1 was 139 miles per hour. And in April, it was 104. For weather station 2, January was 122. April was 113. 3, we had 126 and 100. For 4, we had 64 and 88. And for 5, we had 78. And 61. And then what we are asked to assess is it says, does this information indicate that the peak wind gusts are higher in January than in April? So higher in January than in April? Question mark. And we want to use a 1% level of significance, or alpha equals 0.01. Okay. So here we go. We have data. We need to put that data into lists. So you'll want to go into your stat and edit to find your lists. If you have any data in there, you'll want to clear it out. And then you will want to put, let's say, the January data into the first list. So all of this stuff is going to be L1, and the April data will be L2. Okay, so in here, list 1, was 139, 122, 122, there we go, 126, 64, and 78. And then for the April data, we had 104, 113, 100, 88, and 61. Now, because these data are paired by weather station, right? Here's weather station 1, January, April. Weather station 2, January, April. And so on and so forth. When you put them in your lists, you want those pairings to remain intact. So both of these first observations belong to weather station number 1, January, April. Weather station number 2, January, April. Weather station number 3, January, April. Okay, you want those matched pairs to be lined up next to one another. Then, since we're testing for a difference between the two groups, we are going to make list 3 a list of the differences, or the subtraction operation, between each of these data pairs. And you can certainly do that one at a time. You know, you can calculate 139 minus 104 and put that answer over here, and so on and so forth. Or you can have the calculator do that for you, which for a large list of data certainly saves a lot of time. To have the calculator come up with the differences for you, you want to press the up arrow key here to scroll up until your list 3 is highlighted. Then what you want to do, see down here at the bottom where it says L3 equals. We want L3, this whole thing, to be generated by taking L1 minus L2, right? We want to subtract those two values, L1 minus L2, all the way down. So press second 1 to get list 1 to pop up right there. Then press your subtraction key, then second 2 to get your L2 to pop up. So L3 will equal the difference between L1 and L2. And if you press enter, it will execute that command. If you get an error when you press enter, usually it means you didn't scroll up until your list 3 was highlighted. It usually means you're down here somewhere. So you do have to have that list 3 highlighted before you press enter. And then it populates that list 3 with a list of the differences. And we can see them all there. Okay. Now, once we have that all set up in the calculator, we're ready to go with our normal hypothesis testing steps. A, we want to write our null and alternate hypotheses and identify our level of significance. Okay, null hypothesis and alternate hypothesis, if we're testing for differences in paired data, are both going to be about mu sub d, the mean difference. Null hypothesis always states that there's no difference between the two groups. And the alternate hypothesis is going to depend on what you are testing. Now here, I put my January's in list 1, I put my April's in list 2, and I subtracted them. Now if January is truly higher than April, if I have higher wind gusts in January than in April, and if this is how I did my subtraction, then I would expect this difference on the whole to come out positive if the higher number is here. Okay. If it had said lower in January than in April, I would have a less than symbol here. And if it had simply said different in January than in April, I would have a not equal to here. We're using an alpha equals 0.01 or a 1% level of significance to test that claim. Okay. Now, in part B, this is where we check our conditions. We need a simple random sample. We need we need paired data. And then we need mound shaped and symmetric. Or n greater than or equal to 30. For this particular problem, I didn't read this part to you, but we were told to assume that the differences follow a mound-shaped and symmetric distribution, which is good because we did not have 30 different weather stations reporting. Simple random sample here, it's never really stated that the sample is random, but it's certainly representative. So we can take that as assumed, and the data are paired. They are paired by weather station, and we can see that pairing here. So our requirements are met. In part C, we want to find or estimate the p-value. And doing this by hand, you can do it, and I would be happy to show you the by hand methodology, but you do have to rely on a table to do this because you need to find the critical t value from the t table. And so usually at this point it's just so much easier to do it in the calculator rather than have to look up that critical t value from the t table. So I'll show you the method on the calculator. Again, it's using the t test on L3. And here's how we set this up. So we were here, right? We had put our data in. I'm going to quit out of that screen. And then press stat, go over to tests, select our t-test, But instead of selecting stats, I'm going to select data. Our mean sub-zero, our mu sub-zero from the null hypothesis was zero. We're starting by assuming that the mean difference is zero. And then we want to run the t-test on L3. We are testing that list of differences. So we want to change the list to L3. Frequency should be set to 1. And our alternate hypothesis here had a greater than symbol. So we would want to select that. And then calculate. And so here's our p-value, 0.1408, if we round to four places. And if you're worried about, you know, showing work on a test or an assignment or something like that, usually when you do your t-test on L3, you know, you can indicate that you set your mu sub-zero to zero, you had your list at L3, frequency was 1, and then you had mu greater than mu sub-zero. And then you can say, you know, this is what I put in, and then there's what I got out. And that's a really great way to notate your work, because now I can tell what you did. You ran a t-test on L3. Here's everything you put in. Here's what you got out. Certainly, you could put this down here, because that's the way that you would put it in. You would pick your test, you would do this work, and then you would get this value out. But that way, I can see everything that you've done in the calculator, and I know where to go looking for issues if you're not getting the proper value there. Okay, but basically a 14% p-value. So considering that we set our level of significance at 1%, when we decide are we rejecting or failing to reject the null hypothesis, we have a p-value of 0.1408. That is certainly greater than our alpha level at 1%. And so when we're looking at, is there enough evidence to show that the wind gusts are higher in January than in April? Well, to show that they were higher, we would have needed to have rejected the null hypothesis and concluded the alternate. But here, since our p-value is not low, it's not true that the HO must go. Okay, we're not rejecting the null hypothesis. We're retaining it, or we're failing to reject it. So is there enough evidence to indicate that the wind gusts are higher in January than in April? No, because we weren't able to conclude in favor of the alternate hypothesis. So we fail to reject the null hypothesis. And in context, what that means is at the 1% level of significance, there is insufficient evidence to indicate that the peak wind gusts in Rocky Mountain National Park are higher in January, higher than in April.